some action or decisive action in fiscal stimulus, we certainly will have a recovery. But I expect this kind of recovery is going to be weak.
Over the next 12 to 18 months, yeah. Are you more worried about inflation or deflation?
Well, I think that at this stage, deflation is a major challenge. And inflation, you know, you don't have to worry so much. That's one thing. And secondly, even the government spend a lot of money, whether it's going to be inflationary or not, very much depends on how the government uses the money. For example, in Japan in the 1990s, why the Japanese fiscal stimulus did not work? I had a friend in Japan, stay in Japan for 4 years in the 1990s. He told me that in the 4 years, the road in front of his apartment was dig out, pave, dig out and pave six times.
Only six.
In 4 years, right? And certainly those kind of spending will not generate higher gross return. And it's going to be inflationary. But again, if the government uses the money to invest in area which can generate high return, enhance the growth, then it's not going to be inflationary. Because after the crisis, the economy will become larger. And with a larger economy, it can accommodate more currency, more money. And I give the example in China. Before 98, whenever China had two-digit growth rate, China also had two-digit inflation rate, sometimes even 24%, 25%. But after 2003, China maintained 6 years of two-digit growth rate, but inflation rate was 3 to 7%, much lower. And how come it become much lower? Well, because the capacity become larger. And so even money supply increased a lot during the stimulus period in 98 to 2002. But because the economy become larger, so it can accommodate more money, money in circulation. So the message is very important that currently the terminology we use is shovel ready. When you talk about Keynesian type of intervention, we always say you need to do shovel-ready project so you can immediately work, right? I'd like to change the terminology from shovel-ready to bottleneck relief. And if the government can put the money in area to release its bottleneck, in the short run, you'll create job opportunity, create demand. In the long run, it will pave a foundation for a more sustainable growth. And then it will be a one stone, kill two birds. You can turn the crisis into an opportunity.
In the US, we talk about shovel ready. I think in China, they talk about
caterpillar,
excavator ready, if you look at their sales yesterday. Obviously, there's a lot of concern about currencies, and someone was, when you ask economists, one of them said, you shouldn't think of currencies as horses in a horse race. He said, you should think of trying to pick a horse at the glue factory, because who would invest in sterling, the pound?
Yeah.
Who would invest in the euro? Who would invest in the yen?
Yeah.
And who would invest, because there are reasons for all of those currencies to fall. What's your perception about currencies in general and the dollar in particular?
Well, it's a good question. You know, some people, some economists made its career by predicting the global crisis will be triggered by the collapse of U.S. currencies. We see the collapse of financial sectors, but the value of U.S. currency, in effect, did not decline, but also appreciate. And so I think in the short run, the U.S. currency is likely to be strong because during the deleveraging process, then a lot of capital outflow will return to the U.S. and that will push up the U.S. currencies. At the same time, you know, relatively speaking, although U.S. encounters some kind of crisis, but this is a global crisis. All other countries encounter similar crises. For example, according to our projection, the U.S. economy may decline about 3%, but Japanese economy will decline more than 5%. And so U.S. economy, relatively speaking, is still in a better shape. And so there's some kind of flight to safety. So that's another reason to push up the U.S. Currency. And about the future, that depends on whether U.S. government, you know, learn a lesson from China or learn a lesson from my speech. If the U.S. government can use this fiscal stimulus in areas which enhance U.S. growth, and under that kind of situation, even there's a large currency injection during this period of time, it's not inflationary. And it's not, as long as it's not inflationary, U.S. dollar does not have to depreciate. So pretty much it depends on the policy. You know, if it's right policy, then the U.S. currency will still be reasonably strong. And you know, it does not have to encounter a large readjustment in the international currency system.
Do you think the policy so far is the right policy?
I can see that Obama, his policy announcement is in the right direction. You can see that he always say invest in green economy, in enhance the productivity, in improve the energy efficiency. But once the bill put into the Congress, there's a lot of modification of that. And yesterday, Hank Greenberg said that in the U.S., the fiscal stimulus, 40% of investment, 60% of ideology.
Mm-hmm. And in China, now, if you look at the Chinese stimulus package, obviously there's infrastructure, yeah. But there's a lot of attention paid to small and medium-sized enterprises.
That's very true.
But that's not necessarily the case at the moment here in the U.S., which may relate to your point and Hank's point about ideology.
Well, I think in China, certainly, to support the growth of small and medium-sized enterprises is very important. Because the challenge for the recession is the job losses. And how to create more jobs? Small and medium-sized enterprises is the most important vehicles. And also, it's a right direction for reform, because in the past 30 years, although the Chinese economy grew quite well from the average growth rate, but we also observed income distribution in China become worse and worse. And one reason the income distribution become worse and worse, it was related to the reform in some sectors which lag behind. And it create an environment favor large corporation, rich people. And it's biased against small and medium-sized enterprises and labor force. Specifically, China's financial institution is over-concentrated in the large bank and stock market. We know that only large corporation, rich people, have the opportunity to get financial services from equity market or borrow money from the big banks. And small and medium-sized enterprises, which create a lot of jobs, they cannot get access to those kind of services. And so you favor the development of big corporation and also concentration of wealth in the rich people. Not only so, China is a developing country. Capital is scarce, and price for the capital should be high. But because of over-concentration of the financial sectors, interest rate is artificially suppressed. That means what? Those people who can get the capital from the financial system, they are getting subsidies. Who subsidizes them? Those people who cannot borrow from the big bank will be listed in the stock market are subsidizing the rich people and the large corporation. And so that results in income distribution in China become